Well, good singing tonight, church. Good to see you for our midweek service. Glad you're here and looking forward to a good service tonight. Tonight, beginning a series on the life of Joseph. It's going to occupy us for a few weeks, but it'll be a good study. I have been looking at his life, and then last week we had a bio conference, and almost every preacher that stood up wanted to talk about Joseph. I thought, well, we're just going to go forward with what my plans were then. So we're going to take the series title right from Genesis chapter 50. I think the summary of Joseph's life comes out of Genesis chapter 50. God meant it for good, and everything about him, you just see God's hand involved. So we'll start that tonight. Wanted to give you an update on all those materials that you donated from Sunday. That was overwhelming. As your pastor, I'm just telling you, that was overwhelming to walk in the church lobby and see all of that Sunday evening. People was bringing throughout the day. And we're just grateful to be able to help a few folks over there in Cock County. I appreciate the men that came Monday and helped us load up that truck. That was good. And then we got over to a church that was a dispersion point right off the interstate at exit 435. And several folks at the church helped us unload, and they took it right off of our truck and put it on three vehicles that were going out into a community. Brother Wayne, that's your area over there. Is there a place over there called Grace Community or Gracie's? Or yes. What's the name of that?
Grace Community.
Grace Community. That's the place they were taking all of that. And they loaded up three vehicles, took about probably a third of the water that we donated, and they just left while we were standing there. They loaded up, and they got it out of there as quick as they could. And I just wanted to thank you, church, for your generosity. And I know that meant a lot to some folks over there. They're going to be struggling for a long time. One of the things that we noted when we got to the church, they had two lines, one for dropping materials off and one if you needed the things. And the folks in the pickup line that were trying to get some help, they just looked devastated. Our hearts went out to them. Terry said, oh, Terry just got choked up. And she said, I can't imagine this. And there were just dozens and dozens of people at that one place. And so I appreciate your generosity. If we have opportunity to help again, we'll do so. I think the need over there is going to go on for a long time. Continue praying for all that, if you would. Just a couple of announcements for this weekend. Our Hearts and Hands Ministry is meeting on Saturday, October 5th, and they're going to meet here at 9 o'clock, our deacons and officers at 4:30. And then for those of you, we called Sue earlier, give her a heads up, for those of you involved in our ladies' Bible study tomorrow, I feel like this is ample warning for you. We will not have water here at the church for a number of hours tomorrow. We're having our bathrooms worked on. They've got to go through, and they're replacing all of the flush valves on each of the commodes throughout the whole building. So the water's going to be down for a while. Bio has agreed to let us, if you need to use their facilities. You can just drive right over there while you're here. But keep that in mind. When you come tomorrow, there won't be any water sinks or anywhere else in the building, and that's going to be for most of our day tomorrow, okay? So that's a heads up. It's on video recording that I warned you all right? So keep that in mind. And then I also want to remind you about, we've got a big event coming up at the end of the month, the Fall Festival. It's a Wild West Fall Festival. Looking forward to it. We've got a lot of folks involved in this. I've been getting some interesting pictures of you all that is going to be put on wanted posters. I don't know how good this looks for a church to have so many of our faces on a wanted poster, but that's what we're going to do. That's going to be on October the 26th, and we're trying to make that a great event for our community. This is going to replace our trunk or treat this year. And we may be moving to doing a fall festival every year. We have a number of ministries and churches in our area that do trunk or treat, so we're going to back off of that. And on Saturday the 26th, we're going to start this fall festival. I think it's going to be great. The plans and games that are already in place for that, and it'd be a great opportunity for outreach in our community, I believe. And these kind of things draw families, and that's what we're trying to do, is reach those families that are moving into our community, maybe that haven't settled in a church yet. And so that's going to be our goal. So that's it for this week's announcements. We'll just we'll keep going with our service here. I hope you got a prayer bulletin. There are several updates and additions to the prayer bulletin this week. And so please get one of those if you didn't. When we shake hands here in a few minutes, a few minutes, you can find a prayer bulletin, a Bible study sheet for tonight's Genesis study on Joseph's life. And so if you can find those things while we shake hands, that might benefit you, all right? Good to see you tonight, church. Let's stand together, would you? Brother Jeff's going to come, and he's going to lead us in one more song.
All right, turn to page number 358, please. Page number 358. I am thine, O Lord. I am thine, O Lord. I have heard thy voice and it told thy love to me. But I long to rise in the arms of faith and be closer drawn to thee. Draw me nearer, nearer, blessed Lord, to the cross where thou hast died. Draw me nearer, 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 blessed Lord, to thy precious bleeding side. Take just a moment and greet those around you. We'll come back and sing. Let's lift it up together on that fourth and final verse. There are depths of love that I cannot know till I cross the narrow sea. There are heights of joy that I may not reach till I rest in peace with thee. Draw me nearer, nearer, blessed Lord, to the cross where thou hast died. Draw me nearer, 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 blessed Lord, to thy precious fleeting side. Amen. Thank you. You can be seated.
Thanks, Brother Jeff. Amen. Well, let's close tonight with our prayer time, okay? So why don't we start with our Bible study, just like you keep you on your toes just a little bit. Let's start with our Bible study tonight, and then we'll end our service this evening with our prayer time. Genesis is the book you're heading to, and let's start around Genesis chapter number 30. That might be a good jumping off place. This is a big introductory chapter here, getting into the life of Joseph. You know, the Bible has, if you count them, the Bible has dozens and dozens, if not hundreds, of biographical sketches. Brother John on Wednesday nights is going through Bible biographies with our young people. He's taking one topic per week, and tonight he is talking about Ruth with our teens. There are so many of them, but there is a common thread that runs through most of the biographies in the Bible, and that thread is their sinful failure. You can find that in most of the Bible biographies. You read about Noah, and the Bible says Noah found grace in the eyes of the Lord. And as soon as Noah got off the ark, he got so drunk he passed out in his tent. And then there is David, who committed adultery, and he and Moses both committed murder. Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, three generations in one family that had a propensity to lie when they were put into a jam. Peter, who denied Christ. Thomas and John the Baptist, who expressed some doubt. All through the Bible, you'll find out that its heroes often have one of their spiritual weaknesses recorded. And then there's Joseph, whose name means Jehovah has added. The Bible says he lived to be 110 years old when he died. And there's not one single sin recorded in the scriptures that Joseph committed. Now, you and I do not believe at all that Joseph was a perfect man. There was only one that was righteous, and that's the Lord Jesus Christ. But for whatever reason, the Holy Spirit chose not to record one single sinful event in the life of Joseph. Personally, this is my belief, it's because Joseph is such a wonderful picture of the Lord Jesus Christ in the Old Testament, that just adds to it. But you and I both know that the scripture says all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. That means Joseph. There is none righteous, no, not one. So we know that Joseph wasn't perfect, but he has none of his sins recorded in the scripture. His faith didn't waver, and you know what Joseph went through. And if you don't, we're going to be going through his life in detail for the next few months. He never lost his confidence in God. He never expressed a weak faith. This series I'm entitling is God Meant It for Good, and to introduce the series, I put on your worksheet some points of introduction. So let's just jump into this, and I know that you know Joseph. You're the Wednesday night crowd at a church, so I know that you're familiar with almost everything, if not all of it, in Joseph's life. So my hope is to, as we make our way through this series in the weeks ahead, is to be able to look at a story we already know, yet glean some things that we can apply and learn from Joseph in our life that changes what we do Monday through Friday or Saturday. So, some points of introduction. Here's the first one. And my grammar may not be exactly professional, but it makes my point. Here's the first one. Joseph gets a lot of attention in the Bible. He gets a lot of attention. In fact, he and Abraham have the same number of chapters that record their biography, 14. But when you compare the number of verses that give the details in those chapters, there's about 25% more said of Joseph than there is Abraham. So he gets a lot of attention in the Bible. And let me say this, he's only mentioned four times in the New Testament, so most of his attention is found in the Old Testament, specifically in the Genesis record. So if you want to get to know Joseph, you start reading at chapter number 30, and then you skip a number of chapters that's a parenthetical on his life, and then you pick up again, and we read about him till the end of the book. He gets a lot of attention in the Bible. The second thing is this, Joseph's life is a model of what every believer in Christ should strive to be. A model of what every believer should be. He never wavered. He doesn't fall morally. And you know he faces, we just talked about it a few weeks ago, he faced great moral temptation. But he didn't. He never compromised. He didn't complain. He never lost his power with God. You see all of these things in his life. He stood his ground for God's glory, never sought it for himself, and he demonstrates what faith can do when it comes to triumph if we'll just keep our eyes on God, even in hard circumstances. So he is a model of what every believer ought to be. Third, he's a remarkable picture of the Lord Jesus. There are, someone counted, over 100 specific things in Joseph's life that parallel the life of Christ. There is not another character in the Bible who more clearly represents Jesus Christ than this man Joseph in the book of Genesis. A tremendous type of Christ in the Old Testament, a picture of Christ. That fact alone makes his life worth studying. We'll focus on some of those similarities. And then the last point of introduction is this. And I said perhaps the greatest aspect of Joseph's life is how clearly the hand of God is seen resting on him. God's providence is always at work in his life, even when it doesn't appear to him or to us to be. He's sold off as a slave, or he's sitting in a prison cell. It doesn't look like God's at work, but it is. God was always fulfilling Romans 8:28 in the life of Joseph. All things work together for good to them who love God and who are the called according to his purpose. God was always fulfilling that verse in the life of Joseph, even when it looked like he wasn't at work. So we're going to base our study off of Genesis chapter 50 and verse 20, where Joseph, you remember when he's revealing himself to his brothers, you remember that great dramatic story. I can't wait to get to that, but that's at the very end of the book. But Genesis 50, 20 says, Joseph speaking says, "But as for you, ye thought evil against me, but God meant it unto good to bring to pass as it is this day to save much people alive." So our series title will be God Meant It for Good. And we're going to see how God takes even the very worst circumstances in one of his children's lives, and he uses them for not only his good, but he uses them for God's glory. People saw Jehovah in Joseph. And how many times did we, last week, Brother David was at that conference, and the squires came and visited. How many times do we read in the life of Joseph, "But the Lord was with him"? But the Lord was with him. You always see that God stayed with him. So here's the opening thought for you. The omnipotent, omniscient, omnipresent God works behind the scenes of your life to get glory for himself through you and to bring you and I to a place of Christian maturity. God was growing Joseph in every one of these hard steps. Good times, they're enjoyable, but the hard steps is where we learn. So we're going to come to this first lesson tonight, and I've entitled it, Gold from an Unlikely Mine. Gold from an Unlikely Mine. To introduce it, let's go to Genesis chapter 30 and look at verse number 22. Now we're going to go back, and we're going to look at most of this chapter, but here's Joseph's entry into the world. And God remembered Rachel, and God hearkened to her and opened her womb. And she conceived and bare a son, and said, "God hath taken away my reproach." And she called his name Joseph, and said, "The Lord shall add to me another son." Man, what great, she's a great woman of faith. She has this son after being barren for so long, and as he's being born, she names him Joseph, said, "God's not done with me yet. I'm going to have another son." And she was right. You know, Benjamin comes along a few years later. So we're going to look at this. We're going to look at this passage of scripture tonight and introduce ourselves to Joseph and see where he came from. And keep that thought in mind, if you would. Gold from an unlikely mine. The unlikely mine, so you can see where I'm going here, is Joseph's messed up family. But when you look at Joseph, you know the Bible, the New Testament talks about that vessel of honor. Man, that was Joseph. But you would not have suspected him to come out of the family he came out of. They were nuts. And then here comes Joseph, a wonderful Old Testament picture of Christ. Let's ask God to help our understanding tonight, and then we'll get in on this. Father, thank you for your word. Thank you for Joseph's story. And we know him, and we're familiar with him. We've heard about him since we were kids in Sunday school. Lord, we pray that you would help our understanding tonight to see beyond just the events of his life, but to see your good hand working and to learn what we can to be so much like he was, like Jesus Christ. So bless each family here tonight. Be with our teens and our children in the back, and we pray that their Bible studies profit them as well. In your name we pray, amen. So, we come to Joseph's story. You hear a lot of this phrase today, dysfunctional home or dysfunctional family. And there are a lot of families in our world that are just, They're just in turmoil. Absenteeism among the parents, abuse or neglect, drug use or alcohol use, divorce and arguments among parents in front of kids. And there's just so much turmoil and strife in the homes. And sometimes, and those of you who teach out in the public, mine are teachers out in schools, when you teach some of these kids, you look at them and you're dealing with them. And I see it in the chaplaincy, and Brian and others see it in their job. You look at some of these kids and you're like, they don't have a chance. They just don't have a chance. And your heart aches for them because their homes and their families are in such disarray. Psychologists and sociologists today tell us oftentimes that the impact of our family is going to determine the outcome of our life. They will say things like our background shapes our lives. How we are raised determines how we will live. And that philosophy is presented as if it is absolute, that we are slaves to our past. I am so thankful the Bible does not agree with that sentiment at all. That completely discounts the grace of God in any way. There are some fantastic stories in the Bible, and you may have even, you may be one of them. A person saved out of an unimaginable background, and God does his work of grace in you, and here you come shining for Jesus Christ from a home that nobody would have thought you'd amount to a Christian, much less point people to Jesus yourself. That is gold from an unlikely mine. That's exactly where he was coming from. I want you to know, a long time before he was thrown into a pit or sold by his brothers or was held as a prisoner, falsely accused, or even before he was the prime minister, Joseph spent his formative years in a home that was marked by sin and strife. It's where he grew up. We're going to talk about that in detail tonight. We read the stories in the Bible about Jacob and his family, and we disconnect Joseph if we're not careful. I hope to reconnect those lines for you tonight and remind you of the, for lack of a better term, of the dysfunctional home that Joseph came from. Well, modern thinking suggests that his life should have been a mess. And if all you and I knew about Joseph tonight was his family, we would think, man, that kid doesn't stand a chance. He's going to be so messed up when he grows up. He won't know which end of the world is up and which is down. But thankfully, Joseph proves us wrong if that's our thinking. He did have a bunch of carnally minded brothers. He had a very passive father. But he comes out shining like gold. And so we're going to look at this. We're going to look at this tonight. So let's start with this. Point number one, the miracle of his birth. The miracle of Joseph's birth, and we'll start by talking about the testimony of it. The testimony of his birth. Can we just summarize, for lack of time, can we just summarize Genesis 29 and remind you of some things? In Genesis 29, Joseph goes, or Jacob rather, Joseph's father, he leaves his mom and dad's house, Isaac and Rebekah. He flees from his brother. And he goes to Laban, and he's working with Laban. His uncle falls in love with Laban's daughter. Joseph falls in love with his own cousin, and he wants to marry Rachel. Back then, that was just what they did. We don't have to have that debate tonight. I'm just telling you, that's just what they did. So he falls in love, and you know the story. He works 7 years for Rachel, and on the wedding night, Laban pulls a switcheroo because of a family or cultural custom. The younger sister cannot marry before the older sister. And when Jacob wakes up after his wedding night, there's Leah. He has married the older, and the Bible says, less attractive sister. What in the world had to happen? Can you imagine? I can't even imagine that. It makes me think of that. Did you see that episode, that Andy Griffith episode where they're trying to catch that dude and Barney has to dress up like a bride? You remember that? Absolute best. I think of that when I read this story about Jacob and Leah. And of course, Jacob raises Cain and he says, what did you do to me? What in the world did you do to me? He said, I worked 7 years for Rachel. He says, Laban says to Jacob, fulfill this 1 week of commitment to Leah, and I'll give you Rachel, and you can work for me 7 more years. So a week after he marries Leah, he marries Rachel. They're all living together. Now, I want you to keep that in mind. One man, and he's not the only man in the Bible to have two wives, but I think he's the only one in the Old Testament that marries two sisters. Each of those sisters were given a handmaid by their father when they were married off. Leah was given a woman named Zilpah to be her handmaid, and then Rachel was also given Bilhah as her handmaid. So there are four women, one man living under this one roof. Man, I just can't picture this. In 1 week, he has two wives. They have two handmaids. He obviously loves one more than he does the other. Leah goes into this marriage knowing she was not chosen. Look at chapter 29 and verse 31. And when the Lord saw, I'm telling you all this so you understand the home Joseph was raised in, right? You get that. It's not fair for me to say this was a dysfunctional family and then not let the Bible justify exactly what I'm saying. So verse number 31 of chapter 29 says, and when the Lord saw that Leah was hated, he opened her womb, but Rachel was barren. And Leah conceived and bare a son, and she called his name Reuben. And she said, surely the Lord hath looked upon my affliction. Now therefore my husband will love me. And she conceived again and bare a son, and said, because the Lord hath heard that I was hated, he hath therefore given me this son also. And she called his name Simeon. And she conceived again and bare a son, and said, now this time will my husband be joined unto me. Will he love me more? Because I have borne him 3 sons. Therefore was his name called Levi. Can you believe verse 35? She conceived again and bare a son. And she said, now will I praise the Lord. Therefore she called his name Judah. And then note, she left bearing. She was done. 4 sons, and she's done. So that brings us to chapter 30 and verse number 1. When Rachel saw that she bare Jacob no children, Rachel envied her sister and said to Jacob, give me children or else I die. And Jacob's anger was kindled against Rachel. And he said, am I in God's stead who hath withheld thee the fruit of the womb? And she said, behold, my handmaid Bilhah, go in unto her, and she shall bear upon my knees that I may also have children by her. And she gave him Bilhah, her handmaid, to wife, and Jacob went in unto her, and Bilhah conceived and bare Jacob a son. Rachel said, God hath judged me, and hath also heard my voice, and hath given me a son. Therefore called she his name Dan. And Bilhah, Rachel's handmaid, conceived again, and bare Jacob a second son. And Rachel said, with great wrestlings have I wrestled with my sister, and I have prevailed. And she called his name Naphtali. When Leah saw that she had left bearing, she took Zilpah, her maid, and gave her Jacob to wife. And Zilpah, Leah's maid, bare Jacob a son. And Leah said, a troop cometh. And she called his name Gad. And Zilpah, Leah's maid, bare Jacob a second son. And Leah said, happy am I, for the daughters will call me blessed. And she called his name Asher. And Reuben went in the days of the wheat harvest. Oh, let's stop right there. Let's drop off there and drop down to verse number 19. This will be a good one. Leah conceived and bare Jacob the 6th son. Oh, wait a minute. I got ahead of myself, didn't I? 17. Verse 17. Hard to keep track of all these women and all these children. My bad. Verse 17 says, God hearkened unto Leah. She conceived and bare Jacob the 5th son. And Leah said, God hath given me my hire because I have given my maiden to my husband. And she called his name Issachar. And Leah conceived again and bare Jacob the 6th son. And Leah said, God hath endued me with a good dowry. Now will my husband dwell with me because I have borne him 6 sons. And she called his name Zebulun. And afterwards she bare a daughter and called her name Dinah. Let's stop there. My word, this is amazing here. Just a recap, Leah has four sons with Jacob. Rachel didn't have any children, so she gave Bilhah as a surrogate. Bilhah had two more sons. Leah gives her handmaid, Zilpah, to him. She gives Jacob two sons. Then Leah has two more sons and a daughter with Jacob. Are you confused by all of that? That is amazing. Jacob has 11 children by three women, all living under one tent. Reuben, Simeon, Levi, Judah, Dan, Naphtali, Gad, Asher, Issachar, Zebulun, and finally a girl, Dinah. 10 sons, one daughter. None of them from his favorite wife, Rachel. Not one. I can't imagine how chilly the temperature was in that home. The envy, the jealousy, the tension, the strife, and if you think those things can be present in your home and not impact your children, you are deceived. There are 11 children living in this home, and there was no way these four women were getting along together. Even Rachel's handmaid had to look at her with a judgmental eye. Even I've given your husband two sons. What's wrong with you? Rachel had a hard time accepting it that she was the barren one because she told Jacob, give me children. He'd already had four sons. She couldn't come to admit that she couldn't have any children. The devastation in this home was terrible. Then you come to verse 22 in chapter 30, and God remembered Rachel, and God hearkened to her and opened her womb, and she conceived and bare a son and said, God hath taken away my reproach. And she called his name Joseph and said, the Lord shall add to me another son. What a fantastic story. His testimony is what we're talking about here. His birth is a testimony because God opened a known barren womb. She was not going to have children, but she did. His life is a testimony. He was born due to divine intervention. We have seen that happen in our church, not once or twice, where someone was told they could not have children. Doctors, professionals, you couldn't have children. But that's not up to a doctor or a professional. That's up to God. And in his perfect time, the Bible says he opened her womb and Rachel delivers this. And let me pause and say this. You are here by God's sovereign appointment. God puts you in the family you're in the generation in which you live, for purpose and on purpose. Just like Joseph, your life, my life, is a testimony, should be a testimony of God. Well, that's the testimony of his birth, the timing of his birth. That's the second thing, the timing of his birth. Joseph was the 11th, oh my word, the 11th son born to Jacob. We had some friends in Montana, went to our church. They had several boys, and they were just determined to have a girl. And Tim was like, we're going to have babies till we have a girl. Number 9 was a girl. I was like, that is the best protected girl in the entire state of Montana. Joseph was the 11th son born to Jacob. And from the outside, it looks like Joseph has entered life at a disadvantage. There wasn't much peace in their home. I just don't believe there was. We know the mentality, if you remember back what took place between Sarah and Hagar. There was so much strife there, Abraham had to put Hagar out of his house. I can't imagine it'd be any better with four women working the same thing. He's born into a house of strife. And then not only that, he's the 11th son. He's always going to be the low man on the totem pole. He's always going to be subject to being picked on. There's just no way 10 brothers were all good brothers to him. And we know that later on. One says, we could sell him. And enough of them go along with it to where they sell him. He's always going to be the low man on the totem pole. The timing of his birth was certainly not great. And from a human perspective, you're thinking, he is going to have a terrible life. But thankfully, God doesn't work on a human perspective. God works out his will. He knew what he was doing. And someone, I don't remember which author said this, They said, just like cream, Joseph is always going to rise to the top. And he does, no matter where he goes. And there are times in your life or in my life when the situations don't look premium. In fact, it almost looks like everything's going against us. And for Joseph, almost every place he turned, it seemed like it was always going against him. But God was still in control. We can't count God out. We can't discount God's hand being at work. He had a plan for Joseph. He has a plan for you. He executed his plan with Joseph, and if you and I will cooperate, he'll execute his plan for us as well. This is just how he works. So those two things make up not only the testimony of his birth, but the timing of his birth. That makes up the miracle of his birth. He really shouldn't have been there because his mom wasn't supposed to have children, and yet here Joseph is. The miracle and then the maze. This is where it gets interesting. The maze of Joseph's boyhood. This is where I would like to remind you specifically of the home he grew up in. Now, I think I may have had a tough childhood. I really didn't. I was just blessed. Mom and Dad, I've told you before, Mom and Dad were saved a year before I was born. All I have ever known is the Lord Jesus Christ in our home. I never lived in fear that my father was going to hit me. I never had a thought that my dad might come home drunk. So if you call that a sheltered life, I had a sheltered life. God has tremendously blessed me with my heritage, and I know that. Joseph, not so much. His childhood was really a mess. Let's talk about two things. We're going to talk about the problem areas of his childhood and then the positive. The problem areas of his childhood. I don't know how anybody could survive the turmoil he did with sanity or integrity, the character that he had. I just want to run through. I'm going to consider some of the events that marked his life, and we'll go through them by a summary and chapter. We already talked about the problems in his home. One man, four wives, 12 kids, same roof. That's a minefield, isn't it? That is just a minefield waiting to blow up. But let's look at some summaries here. Genesis 31 tells about the time that Jacob deceived his father-in-law, so he had to flee home. He gathered up all his wives and all his children, and they fled, getting away. And they were gone 3 days before Laban knew about it. When Laban found out, he chased him down. And they had some very harsh words, Jacob and Laban. In fact, when you come to Genesis, toward the end of the chapter, they make a covenant to stay. They put a rock up at a place called Mizpah. They put a rock up, and they both vowed never to cross that rock again. We won't ever see each other again. As far as we know in Scripture, Jacob and Laban never saw each other again. Let me just pause right here. And again, I like to give examples for things that I say so you don't think I'm making them up. I encourage you and I pray that we are people of discernment. But there's a particular chapter and verse in chapter 31 and verse number 49 that it talks about this covenant that they made at this place called Mizpah. And it says this, Genesis chapter 31 and verse number, let's look at 48. They've made this tower of rocks here, stones. And in verse 48, Laban says, this heap is a witness between me and thee this day. Therefore was the name of it called Galeed. And Mizpah, for he said, the Lord watch between me and thee when we are absent one from another. Now, Christian marketers have taken verse number 49, and they have made verse 49 something sentimental, even romantic, to where you can go to almost any Christian bookstore, and you can buy matching necklaces that have these two halves, like they're broken, but they'll fit together, and they'll talk about Mizpah. And they will make it sound like, oh, when we're apart from each other, just like Mizpah, we can be thinking of each other. That is not what's going on at Mizpah. Mizpah is a threat of violence toward the other one. Mizpah is a place where Jacob and Laban said, we will not come together again so we don't tear each other apart. Christian marketers took that verse because they can make a buck off of it. They'll make a little, go look them up. It looks like it'll be half a circle and have broken the edge, and they'll have another half a circle with a broken edge. And they make it very sentimental, or something a boyfriend and girlfriend can share, or a husband and wife. That's not the interpretation of that verse at all. It is a classic example of someone who takes a verse of Scripture, lifts it out of context, and makes it fit what they want to fit. Don't be fooled. Watch. Watch. Jacob and Laban did not leave on good terms. This division here, well, it was witnessed by Joseph. That's chapter 31. Chapters 32 and 33 tell about the reunion between Jacob and Esau. And Jacob is so afraid of his older brother that he divides his flocks up into three groups for one of two reasons. Either he's going to use them for a bribe to pay Esau not to kill him, or he's going to sacrifice that first group while the other two flee. He is so afraid of his brother, and he's walking in fear and not in faith. And Joseph saw that. In Genesis chapter 34, Joseph's half-sister, Dinah, is raped by a Canaanite priest named Shechem. And when his two older half-brothers, Simeon and Levi, find out what happened, they tricked the men in that city, which was also called Shechem, and then they went in and slaughtered the whole city. And Joseph saw that happen in his family. Chapter number 35, as he's a young boy, Joseph sees the death of his mother, Rachel. She dies while giving birth to his only full sibling, a baby named Benjamin. Chapter 35, Reuben, the oldest brother, commits incest with his stepmother, and Jacob does nothing about it. Joseph saw that. Chapter 35, Joseph's grandfather, Isaac, dies. Chapter 37, Joseph then becomes the object of his father's favoritism. May I say this to you? Dad, Mom, you do not do any favors to your children if you play favorites with any of them. You do them no favors. They will have a misconception, and the others will have a very, even if it's hidden, they will have a very deep-rooted resentment of that favoritism. That's evidenced here blatantly in Joseph's life. So think about the home that Joseph grew up in, will you? He was surrounded by rape, murder, incest, treachery, idolatry, jealousy, death, and hatred. And the Bible says all of that was experienced before he turned 17 years old. He wasn't a man through all of this. He's a young man. He's a teenager. What a mess of a family he grew up in. I put on your worksheet how to build a dysfunctional home. If you want to have a home like Jacob and his four wives, here's how you do it. First, be less than honest with your spouse. Be less than honest. Be jealous of other family members. Demonstrate favoritism among your children. Pursue your will in your home instead of God's will. Practice deception to get your own way. And the last one, live a life of anger, manipulation, and control. Now, if you'll follow those six things, I'll almost promise you, you'll end up with a dysfunctional home. If that's your goal, here's the plan to get it. Now, before we move on here tonight, talking about the problem areas in his life, let me say this to you. I know that some of you here might look back on your upbringing, and some of these things are touching sore spots with you. I don't know all of your histories, but God does. Some of you may have been brought up in a violent home or an abusive home, or you saw a sibling that was favored, blatantly favored over you. Just hellish living. That may be your story. And Joseph's story dredges up some bad memories for you, maybe even some hurt, maybe even some resentment. May I tell you to do this? Put your past in God's hands and let Him work His grace in you. There's someone in the Bible who grew up like you did, maybe. And look what God's grace did in his life. It's an amazing story. That's the problem areas of Joseph's childhood. But there are also, thankfully, positive areas in his childhood. Key positives in young Joseph's life. While he was going through all these things, in his first 17 years, in Genesis 32, for example, verses 24 through 32, you have Jacob's life-changing wrestling match with the angel of the Lord, Jesus Christ, I believe. And he comes away from that match. And you remember how he separated himself from his family? And his family was over there, and Jacob's over here by himself, and he has this wrestling match through the night. And when he's reunited with his family, he has a new walk. He's limping now. He has a new name. He's no longer Jacob, which means deceiver. Now he's Israel, which means prince with God. He's got a new walk. He's got a new name. And he has a new life. Because you'll see Joseph after this, no more trickery and deceiving going on. He's changed. And I want to say this to you. Joseph saw the changes in his dad. He witnessed that. And then in Genesis 35, verses 1 through 4, God calls Jacob back to Bethel. And now, God calls Jacob to have his family get rid of all of their false idols. Do you remember Rachel stole her dad's idols? That's why Laban took off after him. She stole the family gods. Well, Jacob leads his family into a revival to worship Jehovah only. And while they're there, Jacob builds this altar. And he worships the Lord, and he gave testimony as to how he met God there in the past. And I can't help but think that Joseph never forgot those lessons that he learned there at Bethel and the testimony of his dad that he heard there. In chapter number 35, in verse number 5, the Bible says that change in Jacob's life, one of the things that manifested itself, look what it says in Genesis 35, 5. This is after the revival that takes place at Bethel. And it says, and they journeyed, Jacob and his clan. And the terror of God was upon the cities that were round about them. And they did not pursue after the sons of Jacob. Part of that changed life and the blessing of the Lord added to them was a holy protection that caused people who saw Jacob and his family moving, caused them to be afraid of him. The Bible says they would not pursue after them. That had to impact Joseph as a teenager. All these things going on. I told you before about my parents being saved before I was born. But there were other adults that impacted my life as a kid. I think of Mrs. Stansberry and Mrs. Chadwell, who were my first, second, and third grade, my primary class Sunday school teachers. Mrs. Stansberry and Mrs. Chadwell. When I was in those classes, those women, they just seemed older than dirt. They must have been at least 50. They just looked like such old women. But you know, they're the only teachers I ever remember teaching the primary class at Community Baptist Church in Garden City, Michigan. And then I got promoted to the boys' junior class. And Mr. Robleski, Roy Robleski, was my Sunday school teacher. And he took me through a Bible memorization course. And he was my memorization partner. And I was third grade, fourth grade, something like that. And he and I are quoting Bible verses together through a Bible memory. He invested in my life. And then I went from there to my sixth grade Sunday school class, and there was a man there named Mr. Tomlinson, and he was my Sunday school teacher. Come to find out, 15 years before that, he was also teaching that class when David Cross, who used to pastor here, went through that Sunday school class. Mr. Tomlinson was still teaching that class, sixth grade boys. Can you imagine? Taught that class for over 20 years. I just want to tell you folks, you do not know the impact you will have on children. You can't know it. You can't know the impact you're going to have. So do what you can with the children you're teaching, the children you're raising. Stay true to what God's given you. Well, this is the miracle of his birth, the maze of his boyhood. What an absolute mess in his 17-year life. And then the last thing I want to close with tonight, and then we'll get to our prayer time, that's the message from Joseph's battles. The message from Joseph's battles, because through all of these things, there are some great things for us to glean. Let's start with, first of all, a message regarding hope. Looking at his life, and what a mess of a family, hardships, terrible circumstances, gross immorality. And yet there's a message of hope here. What does he teach? Well, here's the thought. His early years teach us that one's childhood doesn't have to ruin them. Your past and my past doesn't have to define us. You may have had it rough growing up, and I'm certainly not discounting that. I'm thinking now of all those children over in eastern Tennessee and western North Carolina who part of their childhood is they lost everything they had. I'm not discounting that there are hardships in life, not in the very least. But I'm saying we don't have to be defined by that. You may have been raised in a home where harsh words were used. You may have been raised in a place where violent tempers were displayed. But I'm saying that doesn't mean you have to use that language and you don't have to repeat that bad behavior. Our past does not have to define us. Look at Joseph. Well, my dad had a temper, and so did his dad. Well, my mom was an alcoholic, so it's in my blood. We can say those things, but that's not true. As I said a few moments ago, those thoughts completely ignore the power of the grace of God in a person's life. And Joseph demonstrates all of that. God's grace is always going to be bigger. Make godly choices. I don't care what your dad did or your mom or your grandparents. It doesn't matter what they did. Make godly choices. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. And lean not to your own understanding. In all thy ways acknowledge him. And he shall direct thy paths. Not your past. Not an ungodly heritage. Why don't you do this? Why don't you be the turning point in your family's lineage where all that godlessness in the past takes a hard 180-degree turn and you be the beginning of a godly heritage that you can pass on to your children and your grandchildren and your great-grandchildren? Be that change. Make that difference. God's grace is always going to be bigger. Blaming actions on people in the past is the smokescreen of a heart refusing to repent of sin and to be changed by God's power. God will change you if you'll let him. God will help you. He will take shackles of the past off if you'll let him. We can't allow the past to define who we are and ignore the grace and the power of God in a person's life. I think of Peter and Paul. King David, King Josiah, all of them had sin in their past, and yet look how greatly God used them. So Joseph's battles bring a message of hope. Your past may have been terrible, but that doesn't define your future. Let God do that. There's a message of hope. Second, there's a message regarding home. And this, again, comes to you married couples and those of you even who have children in your home. Our homes should be sanctuaries of godliness. Every parent ought to be fervently praying that God would give his wisdom and discernment to make your home a place where Jesus rules, where his praises are heard, and where your ways make it easy for the Holy Spirit to impact your children. Now, your children aren't always going to respond to God like you want them to. But don't let that be your fault, and don't let that be my fault. Make your home a godly sanctuary. Make it a place where the Holy Spirit can work. The children that live in your home ought to hear the gospel It ought not to be only at church. They ought to hear the gospel in your home. The children in your home should see the gospel lived out. The Bible should not only be read in your home, but it should be obeyed in your home. And whether you have children or not, your home ought to be a place where the Lord Jesus Christ is exalted in front of everyone who comes into your home. Let them see Jesus there. You'll hear people say, when we walk into your church, we just sense the presence of God. Why can't that be true in my home? And why can't that be true in your home? When they come to our homes, let that be a sanctuary of godliness. Let Jesus Christ be lifted up there. There is this message of for hope. There's a message for the home. There is a message, finally, regarding help. And again, I come back and I say, Joseph's troubled early years, from those early times and all the tragedy and all the sin that he was exposed to, God took a raw piece of ore and he refined it and he shaped it into a beautiful golden vessel of honor. He did that with Joseph's life. All that turmoil and all that dysfunction, I might say, man, he's going to come to nothing. But there's a little two-word phrase that's found 44 times in the King James Bible, and the phrase is, but God. And I was going through these this afternoon and looking at the 44, and I thought, there is a sermon series here waiting to be developed. Do this on your computer, your Bible program on your computer. Search for that phrase, but God, just the two-word phrase, and it'll bring up, at least with King James, it'll bring up 44 passages. Blah, 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 but God. This, but God. Can I give you a sampling of them? But God suffered him not to hurt me. But God shall be with you. But God will redeem my soul from the power of the grave. But God is the judge. But God was with him. But God raised him from the dead. But God commendeth his love toward us. But God gave the increase. But God hath called us to peace. But God had mercy on him. Do you see the pattern? There is a message of hope in Joseph's battles. Listen to Joseph's testimony. But God meant it unto good, to bring to pass as it is this day, to save much people alive. I have made so many mistakes as a husband and as a dad and as a pastor. But God. I don't know what your life looks like before, but God. Joseph went through a terrible 17-year life, and that was before he was sold into slavery. But God. I see children growing up, and so do you, and the deck is stacked so hard against them, and you're wondering if they ever have a chance to make it out. But God can do a work in their lives. And he may use you to bring that work about. It's an amazing life that Joseph ends up living. Would you stop and think for a moment? Most of Joseph's life was lived in turmoil and in strife. And it wasn't until he was promoted out of prison into the prime minister's seat that we begin to see Joseph finally living a life of peace. And he points it out to his brothers. And then he dies in a good old age, the scripture says, 110 years old. Man, if I'd have had the beginning of Joseph's life, I don't think I'd have wanted to live 110 years. And yet he just stayed faithful to God. He looked at God. He kept his faith true in God. I know this circumstance is no good, but God. And that's how Joseph lived his whole life. A wonderful piece of gold from a very unlikely mine. And that can be you, and that can be me. when God wanted an apostle to the Gentiles, he went to an unlikely mine and dug a piece of ore that no one would have chosen, a religious persecutor of Christians, a Jew named Saul, who God transformed into the great missionary Paul. When God wanted to replace Saul as king, he went to an unlikely mine and he dug out an ore from the city of Bethlehem. No one would have chosen that forgotten shepherd boy, David, but God did and transformed him into a man after God's own heart. And when God wanted to fulfill his promise to Abraham, to make Abraham's seed a great nation, and he had to preserve Abraham's seed due to this massive drought and famine throughout most of the Middle East and Africa, God chose, he went to an unlikely mine and he chose a little known piece of ore. In fact, an Israelite prisoner in an Egyptian prison cell, and brought him out and made him prime minister, the second most powerful man in the ruling world empire at the time. God's grace is always bigger. Would you just remember that in your dark hours? It's easy for me to say that when it's going right, but if my home were washed away, I need to be reminded that God's grace is bigger. If my loved one dies unexpectedly, I have to be reminded God's grace is bigger. If my job is taken away or prices go beyond my ability to pay them, I have to remember that God's grace is bigger. And God proves that again and again and again. Your closing thought is this: the Bible and the church are filled with stories just like these, just like Joseph's and David's and Saul's. God takes us in spite of our past as raw pieces of ore, and he shapes us into a vessel of honor that he can use for his glory. And that's the key. It can't be about me. It has to be about him. This is our introduction to Joseph tonight. If all you knew, and you're at a disadvantage because you know Joseph's story, but if all you knew was Joseph's first 17 years of life and his family, if that's all you knew, there is no way, I don't care how much you tell me, I would think that. There's no way you would pick Joseph to end up like he did. Look at this kid. He's surrounded by such terrible sin. If all I know is his family, I'm never picking Joseph to be a Bible hero. He's going to end up a mess. To use Paul's phrase, he's going to end up a shipwreck. But God. I'm so thankful that God takes what people mean for evil, and he's able to turn that around and use it for good. Don't you love Isaiah's verse that says, God can give us beauty for ashes? Joseph's life proves that. So let's look at Joseph for the next few weeks on Wednesday nights, all right? I say few weeks, I'm being conservative. We're probably looking at 3 or 4 months. It'll be a worthy study, I promise you, and it'll be an encouragement to you. Can we take our prayer bulletin and look at this tonight, and then we're going to close in prayer. While you're getting it, let's please continue praying, would you, for our neighbors in these nearby counties and over in the Carolinas. I know Asheville is getting a lot of attention on the national news. I know that, but it's to the detriment of a lot of these small communities that are just completely devastated. So let's pray for our neighbors. And someone asked if we're going to be doing more as far as getting some resources together. If you'll give me a little bit to look into this. FEMA has taken, they've really taken over a lot of the rescue and relief stuff now, and so I think things are going to be different. We were driving to church tonight, and my wife said, we timed this just right, because we got in there before the federal government got really involved. We just drove up to a church and unloaded that stuff, and they just took it where they wanted to take it and probably knew who needed it most, and it worked out great. Going forward, we'll let you know if there's other ways we can help them, okay? Let's make our way through the bulletin. We have added 4 names at the beginning of the first column, those needing salvation. Jessica Smith, many of you know Jake and Jessica that come. They usually sit right over here in this area, and they're pretty faithful in coming. They've asked us to pray for their daughter, Haley Brown. Haley's not saved, and she's dealing with addiction and a godless lifestyle. And if you would pray for her, Jessica hasn't seen her daughter in 2 years, has no idea where she's at. And so please pray for this girl to be saved, if you would. Bob and Joyce Walden are asking us to pray for their son-in-law, Brandon Huff, to be saved. He's also dealing with some personal issues. He's incarcerated. He made some unwise decisions down in Georgia, and he's been arrested. So pray for him, Brandon Huff, to be saved, if you would. His mom, Brandon's mom, is Angie Huff, also unsaved. She's recovering from a stroke and has a blood clot in the back of her neck that possibly is going to require surgery. And so that she's not in good health. She needs to be saved as well. Then the Waldens also asked us to pray for Katie Godfrey. Again, she's unsaved, and she's in a recovery center for addiction. And so let's pray for these four, if you would, for Haley and Brandon, Angie and Katie. And then we've added two names to the cancer list. Ed LeMaster, this is Gail Davis's brother-in-law. Excuse me, his prostate cancer has returned. And so pray for Ed, if you would. Would you also pray for his wife, Gwen, as she's giving him care? And then right below that, Gail also asked us to pray for Brad Davis, who has spleen cancer. And so let's be praying for them. And then all of these others, obviously, that are listed here. Under the physical and other needs, I spoke with Brother Mark Burford right before church this evening. He's going to be having kidney surgery on Friday, October 4th. He said that's going to be day surgery, so Lord willing, he'll be home Friday night. But please pray for Brother Mark. His heart is he would much rather be able to come to church. He said it's so frustrating not being able to do what he wants to do, and most of that involves being involved with a church family. So pray for Mark and Becky, if you would, especially on Friday. I would also ask you to pray for Phyllis McCarter. Phyllis ended up in the hospital Monday. She had a terrible tooth infection. Her jaw was extremely swollen, and they put her on IV antibiotics for a couple days. She was transferred Monday afternoon, I believe, to Nova at Turkey Creek. Her heart is in AFib, and her blood pressure is pretty high, and they were unable to get that down as of Monday afternoon. And so please continue praying for Phyllis, if you would, and she appreciates your prayers. And then also be praying for Evelyn Smith. She's fallen a couple times this last week and a half or so, and she's pretty bruised up and stuck at home. And so please pray for our sister Evelyn, if you would. Sandra Kelly, she and her husband come to our church. She's going to be having a heart cath tomorrow on the 3rd. I'm not sure where that's going to take place, but if you'd be in prayer for Sandra, I know she would appreciate your prayers for that. And then the lad's granddaughter, Aubrey, is going to have a week from today, actually. She's having reconstructive ear surgery. You know Aubrey's been, she's been on our prayer list a lot because of ear problems. And that young girl's had a tough time of it. So let's pray for her, if you would. And then Ann Galloway is Gail's sister, and she's still dealing with vertigo. And so please be in prayer for Ann. Those are the ones that we've added or updated this week. So let's be in prayer for them. Clint Taylor had knee surgery yesterday, and I messaged Ruth this afternoon. I said, "How's Clint doing?" And she said, "He is so enjoying sitting without any knee pain at all." And she said, "He really is coming along great." And she said, "In fact, he's talking about getting out and mowing the lawn." And I told Ruth, I said, "We're going to pray for his recovery, and we're going to pray that you can keep him from doing too much too soon." Clint is not a sitter, and so please pray for him. But I'm thankful that knee surgery went well. He is going to have some more tests done in a couple of months because of some back pain. They're going to be doing some neurological tests on Brother Clint. So if you'd pray for him, he's had a rough year this year, and he starts physical therapy on Friday, and I know that'll help his healing. But let's continue praying for that family, if you would. And then I wanted to let you know tonight, church, that our sister Jean LeCoulter went home to be with the Lord yesterday. Jean has had a long battle here the last couple of years with dementia. Jean was saved late in life and had such a deep appreciation for the grace of God coming out of a cult that deceived her. And when she got saved, she's one of those people, and you've heard the saying, when she got saved, she really got saved. That was Jean LeCoultre. Didn't matter what you wanted to talk to her about, she was just so thankful that God rescued her. And I have every confidence that I'm going to see Jean again. I'd like you to pray for her family. They're going to be traveling from Wisconsin and from Toronto, Canada. And we'll have a graveside service for her sometime next week. Until her son and her stepson get into the state and get things ironed out, we won't know. They should be coming in the next couple of days. But somewhere the beginning to the middle of next week, we'll have a graveside service locally. The church will be invited. And we've opened the door to possibly serve a meal to that family. So Terry, my wife, will be coordinating that with them as well. But I'd like you to pray. There's several people in that family that need the Lord Jesus Christ. And that was probably the greatest burden that Jean carried on her heart, was her unsaved family. And she's convinced that they need Jesus. And so let's pray for them. No need to pray for Jean anymore. She's far better off than you and I. And then Charlie Jones is asking us to pray for Arville Jones. His daughter, Renee, passed away Saturday. Arville's not the one who died. The daughter passed away. But Arville and his wife were in terrible health. Renee was in terrible health, and they're all at home trying to care for each other. And it was just, Charlie was explaining some of the difficulties the family was having, and my goodness, talk about people that were carrying a heavy burden. So let's pray for Renee's family, if you would, and pray for him. I believe he and Pam were headed over there today or tomorrow to minister to their family. So be praying for them, if you would. We have our military personnel listed there. Let's certainly pray for our military, especially those serving in the Middle East. Pray for the people that our government will come down on the right side of this over there. I believe what we're seeing fulfilled is scripture, and let's pray for our men and women that are serving, especially over there. On the back of the page, you have our missionaries listed here, these that are sent out of our church. Brother Terry Childers is preaching a missions conference this coming Sunday through Wednesday in Fremont at the Fremont Baptist Temple. He's asked us to pray that God would burden their hearts to grow the missions ministry there. He's going to be preaching, I think he said, 6 times in 4 days. And so pray for them. They've already left for that trip. Pray for Brother Rob at the end of this month going back to Ethiopia. Pray he finds housing over there, that God would be even leading the way now. Johannes Gatana will be flying back to Zambia tomorrow. He begins his trip home tomorrow and gets home on Saturday. So pray for his long trip home. And then he asked us this last week to pray for these three things. He asked us to pray for more classrooms to be added to the main school, a new vehicle, a reliable vehicle, and for some health issues that Kittist has been dealing with for some time. So let's pray for them. Matt and Melanie Parrott, our newest missionaries sent out of the church down in Bolivia, pray for the deaf. Brother David, are these the missionaries you're going to hopefully see at the beginning of the year? It says pray for the 800 deaf in their city without a church. Brother David is hoping to make a trip down there after the first of the year to maybe look at how they can begin a deaf ministry there. So that's good news. Amber Yingling, serving the Lord in the Philippines. John and Nikki, pray for them as well. And I appreciate their work with our teenagers on Wednesday nights. Pray for Burhanu and Wubit. Would you add a prayer request right in there? We were praying for Sega. I shared with you a couple weeks ago that the Filipino government was not going to accept the wedding, the marriage license that he brought from Ethiopia because it didn't have a certain authentication. Another complication is that Sega lost his passport in the Philippines, and he has no documents to travel with internationally. And so he is, I was with him on WhatsApp yesterday and told him that we would pray for him. So do that. He's got to work through the Ethiopian embassy that is in Seoul, South Korea, because the Philippines doesn't have an Ethiopian embassy. And it's quite significant. He's been there for nearly 2 months, and or right at 2 months now, and he needs our prayer. The wedding has not yet taken place. What they're going to do is he and Christine and Christine's father are going to go back to Ethiopia once he gets a passport. The wedding will take place there. So Satan's doing his best to discourage this young couple. And let's pray for them, pray for their hearts, pray for their peace, and pray that God would lubricate the process, oil the process of getting him a replacement passport so they can get home. Then at the bottom, we've mentioned three additional missionaries that we partner with: the Shenandoah Boys Ranch and Haven for Girls, located here in Cleveland, Tennessee, homes for troubled teenagers. The teens have to want to get help. They can't. It's not a fenced facility at all, and they have to want help. And so they are currently at the, I think they're without a director at the Boys Ranch. Is it the Boys Ranch or the Haven? The ranch, the boys. So they don't have any boys at the ranch right now because they don't have a director. So let's pray for that. That's the first time I remember that happening in the history of that ministry. Kyle and Hannah serving the Lord in Chile, and then Andy and Lisa, longtime missionaries in Taiwan, both of them dealing with some health issues. And so let's pray for them, if you would. A lot to pray for. And so let's do that, and we'll close tonight. I'm so thankful to see each one of you. It's good to have the Godbys here. Missionaries to New York, and so we're glad that they could be with us tonight. He's been helping his dad with some stuff, and if you get a chance to meet their family, please greet them if you would. Why don't we stand together and have prayer? You've been sitting for a while. Appreciate you being here tonight, church. Appreciate you praying for one another and for all of these that we've mentioned here tonight. Let's take them to the Lord. Father, thank you for inviting us into your presence as children, that we're no longer enemies. You've taken that enmity away, and you said as sons and daughters, we can come boldly to your throne and be confident that there's grace to be had there in our time of need. And so your grace in every situation that we're going to mention tonight, Lord, is what we're praying for these to be saved, for Haley and Brandon, Angie and Katie, and difficult, every one of them, God, difficult situations, but not beyond the reach of Jesus Christ. And so we pray that you'd save them. Be long-suffering with them, God. And I know that they've all heard the gospel before. Would you please bring them to Jesus through some avenue? I pray, Lord, also that you'd be with Ed and Brad dealing with cancer, all of these dozens of names here dealing with cancer. And Lord, we ask that your healing touch would be on them according to your will. I pray for Brother Mark as he comes into surgery this Friday, that this would correct the problem. Mark has enough health issues, Lord, and if it would please you to guide the surgeon's hands so that his healing can be brought out. Lord, that's certainly our prayer, that he can go home and begin to convalesce as soon as possible. I pray for Becky as she cares for Mark, and we're thankful for that couple. Thanks for bringing them to our church. We pray that we'd be careful to minister to them as they need it. We lift up our sister Phyllis McCarter to you, and Lord, I'm hoping that her heart is back in rhythm, that her blood pressure is coming down, and that you would be with her and Harold. I'm so thankful for their faithfulness to you. They love you, Lord, and I pray that you would bless them, touch her body, and I pray the same for Evelyn. So sorry to hear that she's hurt and has been dealing with these falls, and we pray, Lord, that you would watch over her. Pray for Sandra and this heart cath that she's having tomorrow, God, and pray that whatever the doctors are looking for to correct, that they would find it and be able to take care of the issue there. We continue to pray for Aubrey, and Lord, bless that girl, and I pray that this surgery on her ear is productive. She's had a hard time. Lord, you already know that, and I ask that you would be merciful to Aubrey and help the Ladd family. I do pray for Ann and this ongoing issue of vertigo. It would be great if the doctors could discover that cause, and it sounds like they need you to open up their understanding in that, so please do that. Thank you for bringing Clint through his surgery, and Lord, I'm glad to hear he's doing well. I pray that he's patient in his recovery and that when he starts therapy, it would only advance his healing. Lord, I thank you for Clint and Ruth. I pray that you'd bless them, bless their family. And Lord, thank you for letting us know Jean LeCoulter. I thank you for saving Jean and for bringing her here. Her love for Jesus, her love for missionaries, and her love for your church was just evident. Even when she didn't feel good, Lord, I would just, her face lit up to tell people about her Savior. And I pray that her sons and her daughters-in-law would come to Jesus because of her testimony. I pray for Arville Jones and his wife. They grieve the death of their daughter. And I pray, God, that you would use Charlie and Pam and others in that family to comfort them. I'm so thankful for the Christian family that Charlie has. And I know Arville's a believer. And I pray, Lord, that your Holy Spirit would come alongside and comfort them. I pray for each of our missionaries. We're especially thinking of Brother Terry, as he's got a lot of preaching responsibility this next week, focusing this church's attention on the worldwide need for the gospel. And I pray, Lord, that you would fill him with all the things that you've laid on his heart and keep his thoughts organized, and may he preach in your Holy Spirit's power and you do your work in that church. I do pray that you would be with each of those missionaries that we get to partner with. And Lord, whatever the needs that they have, some are looking to expand their ministries. The parents are looking where they should minister next. Lord, they need direction and they need provision and protection, discernment. And Lord, we pray that all of those things they would be trusting in you for. I pray, Father, that you would be with our neighbors over in Cock County and Greene County, some of those even here in this county, Lord, all of those in North Carolina and South Carolina. I think 1 million people without power. 160-something families grieving the loss of their loved ones. So many more grieving the loss of everything they have. Lord, may we be careful not to get too comfortable. And Lord, may we be generous in our giving to people we may never meet. Nobody's ever going to send us a thank you card. But Lord, if we can give cups of cold water in your name, and we can go beyond praying for people, but giving what we have so others can be comforted, then help us to have your perspective on the poor and the needy. Lord, you love them. Saved or lost, you love them. And I pray that we could be your heart and your hands and your feet in the months ahead in helping these folks. We know that you're a good God. You're faithful in all things. This world is turning upside down. Your people in Israel are being attacked. And you said when we start seeing the things that we're seeing now that we ought to look up. Our redemption is drawing nigh. And Jesus, we are so thankful for the hope, the blessed hope that we have of your appearing. Help us to love it. Help us to live in light of it. And I pray, God, that when you come, you'll find this group of believers doing what we should be doing to please you and honor you and point people to Jesus Christ. Bless these families tonight, each one of them, as they travel home. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you, church. It's good to see each one of you tonight.